This is Windows 95. Released in August 1995, its plug-and-play hardware detection was one of its key features designed to simplify hardware configuration. And this is Windows NT 4.0 from 1996, sporting the fancy new Windows 95 shell and some other improvements along the way. However, there was no official plug-and-play support in plain sight. Or was there? Under the dust, there's history waiting to boot. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. While Windows 95 received a massive marketing push, complete with a video guide featuring Jennifer Aniston and the late Matthew Perry, Windows NT didn't get nearly as much attention. Originally designed for workstations and servers, NT 4.0 shared a visual resemblance with the more consumer-friendly Windows 95. But as we discussed in a previous episode, you could also retrofit the Windows 95 shell onto Windows NT 3.51, giving it a more modern feel. There are some rare sources suggesting that there were plans for an intermediate release between NT 3.51 and NT 4.0, but with limited documentation, this remains a bit of a mystery. Looking at better release dates, NT 4.0 actually dates back to July 1995, just a few weeks after NT 3.51's release. This timing makes it likely that the rumored NT 3.6 was essentially rebranded as NT 4.0 to align with Windows 95's internal version number. Despite the excitement surrounding NT 4.0's speed and stability improvements, like the move of the graphics device interface GDI into kernel mode, which greatly boosted performance, and the introduction of partial DirectX support internally, it was still referred to as the shell update release. So, from a development perspective, NT 4.0 was more of an evolution than a revolution, especially when compared to the major changes that would come with Windows 2000. But despite that, NT 4.0 laid a solid foundation, bringing not only the workstation and server editions, but also the NT 4.0 terminal server edition, as well as the first version of Windows NT Embedded, eventually succeeded by Windows XP Embedded, which I had featured in a previous episode. Besides that, even though Windows NT wasn't officially known for supporting plug and play, it's not entirely accurate to say it didn't.
Oh, come on, it says right here, NT4 didn't support plug and play.
Not out of the box. But unlike USB support, which was also absent from NT 4.0 and required third-party drivers, Microsoft actually included a basic plug and play service. It's just buried on the NT 4.0 install CD-ROM, hidden under the PNP ISAP directory. There's not much to go by, the driver itself and an INF file. With zero documentation, your best bet is to right-click the INF file and hit Install. Then reboot Windows NT. That's it. Almost. To simulate this, let's add some new hardware. For simplicity, I'm using 86-box to emulate a late 90s machine, specifically one with a PNP BIOS, which is absolutely required for this to work. Then I'll add a sound card. And not just any Soundblaster 16, but the plug-and-play variant. Some ISA cards from the era supported three configuration modes. PNP mode, to use the BIOS to assign resources. Manual mode, which is configured with jumpers. And then there is software or jumperless mode, which requires a setup utility to program the EEPROM. Take this card I showed you in an earlier episode on 10Base2 networking. It supports all three, but for this test, we stick with PNP mode. As the system boots up, the card is recognized during the BIOS's PNP init phase. And once we log in into Windows NT, something quite familiar kicks in, a hardware detection flow not unlike to Windows 95. From there, it's simple, point it to the right driver and the rest happens mostly automatically. But if you're now reaching for Device Manager, well, sorry, there isn't one. Instead, there's a Devices applet in the Control Panel. It lists all installed drivers, including our newly detected SP16 PNP, but offers no configuration options. Another sign of just how experimental this implementation really was. Documentation practically non-existent. I checked all sorts of sources inside Windows NT 2nd edition from 1997, the NT resource kit, SDKs and DDKs, you name it. No real mention. A few obscure knowledge base entries do reference the ISAPNP service. One of them even warns against using it, but then another one suggests it's required for certain newer drivers. That's quite some mixed messages, huh? Digging into the README for the SPPNP, also found on the NTCD, things get a bit clearer. You must have a plug-and-play BIOS and it only works with properly PNP-aware cards. I swapped out the SP16 for a Sandblaster AWE32 and it still worked. But when I added a Realtek RTL8019AS network card, even though it was reported by the BIOS and detected by NT, installation failed even with the PNP driver. And the same thing with the AMD PCNet network card. And again, there's no GUI to configure these. No detection of hardware removal and no graceful fallback. If you pull out the PNP card, NT just throws a vague error at startup and logs something to the event log as shown here to indicate a driver failed to load. The ISAPNP service doesn't remove or disable the old driver. It simply wasn't built for that. So yes, NT 4.0 technically had plug and play, but it was experimental and limited. It worked only under the right conditions, new hardware, proper BIOS extensions and compatible drivers. It wasn't the plug and play like on Windows 95. There was no device manager, no intuitive user interface and no automatic configuration cleanup. Still, Microsoft did include it and in some cases, like newer drivers, they even recommended using it. So what do you think? Did you ever use the ISAPNP service in Windows NT? Did it work for you or drive you nuts? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again next Sunday.